Thank you so much for joining us again. It's lovely to see you. And this afternoon, we are exploring the beautiful, stunning historical city of Oxford. And I'm sure many of you will have been there and visited, but we're just going to have a little tour through. So let me just. Yeah, for some reason, apologies, screen share is not working. Right, here we go. So a little bit of a lovely tour of Oxford, and we are very lucky actually with all of the wonderful connections that we have in Oxford, both through Lisa, who worked there for some time, and also through guides and hotel owners and so on. So we really can provide some rather fabulous access to some of the hidden wonders of Oxford for your clients. And the wonderful thing, as you will probably know, it is so centrally located. So it's perfect to stop for a couple of nights and go exploring, but is easily done from London. But we'll come on and talk about the location. And I love this quote from Yeats, because I think Oxford, for so many people, it does take your breath away. It's so beautiful, and many of our guests say that they feel sort of quite literary and artistic and even musical when they go there, which is just lovely. So as you know, I love my history, and a little bit like Windsor, Oxford first sort of gained its strategic significance in Norman times about 1,000 years ago, and because it sits on the junction of the Thames and the tributary, the River Cherwell. William the Conqueror discovered that it was going to be strategically very important if he controlled those access points. And so originally the town of Oxford started to emerge. By the 14th century, it was really it was completely dominated by the university, and there was almost nobody in the town at the time that wasn't involved in the university. But then it sort of it grew quite a bit, and then its ecclesiastical history caught up with it in the mid 16th century during the Reformation. And it really was the centre of all sorts of intrigue, from initially because of all of its Catholic links, when Henry VIII became leader of the Church of England. But then it was one of the biggest Protestant uprisings during the time of Edward VI, who was obviously sort of fighting back against all of the Protestants. So there was some rough times, really rough times. And there's a fabulous book, actually, I've just remembered reading, a novel called The Instance of the Finger Post. If you're interested, I will send you I'll find the author and send it to you, because it's a fabulous read about Oxford during those times. And then about 100 years later, it became the centre of the royal household, because Charles I set up his royal court in Oxford during the Civil War, and it really was bombarded by the parliamentarians and Cromwell's cronies. So, who were obviously ultimately successful. So. Oxford has certainly seen quite a lot of activity, and interestingly, also during the Second World War, apparently Hitler instructed the Luftwaffe not to bomb Oxford, because he planned to, as you may remember when we talked about Blenheim, he planned to set up residence at Blenheim Palace and have Oxford as his capital city. So Oxford was saved from the horrors of all the bombing, so which is great to look at today. And just a few little interesting facts that you might or might not know. Obviously, it is one of two centres of learning in the UK. My partner went to Cambridge, so I'm not allowed to say it's the best, but it is one of two. But it has produced 27 of our prime ministers, which is quite extraordinary for a single university. But they didn't quite catch on to women in the learning environment for a little while. Women were first admitted as students in 1878, which seems really rather late. But it wasn't until 1974 that all of the colleges finally admitted women to stay and take up residence as students. So they were a little bit slow on that front, one might say. And C.S. Lewis famously crafted Alice in Wonderland during his time. He was a maths professor at Oxford. It was based on the daughter of a friend of his called Alice Liddell. And there's a rather gloriously romantic story, well, sort of romantic story, that Alice Liddell met Prince Leopold, one of Queen Victoria's sons, during their time in Oxford, and fell totally in love. But very sadly, Queen Victoria banned them from seeing each other because Alice wasn't a princess and Prince Leopold had to marry a princess. But when they both did get married to other people, Alice had a son and called him Leopold. And one of Leopold's daughters, Prince Leopold's daughters, is called Alice. So they obviously never quite forgot about each other, which is rather lovely. Now, when we take your clients to explore Oxford, there are a number of ways of doing it. And as we said when we were talking about Bath and Windsor and so on, a really lovely, simple way really experiencing it, not just seeing Oxford, is a glorious walking tour. Our guides are absolute experts, and they love the whole the history and the drama and the stories, and they'll tell you all about the prime ministers and what they got up to. They'll point out the original door to Narnia and so on. So it really is lovely. But something that we've created for clients who want something a little bit more upbeat and interactive are some rather fun treasure hunts around Oxford. So these enable your clients to see all of the best bits because they have to find them to follow the clues. But there's a little bit of competition and who gets back first, and we obviously have a suitable prize and all that sort of thing. So we've seen some fabulous, the competitive spirit come out in some family groups, that's for sure, between father and son and mother and daughter and that sort of thing, which is, it's just a really fun way to go exploring Oxford. And it's all height of modern technology, obviously, and they're all given tablets to follow the clues and so on. So if you wanted something a little bit different, then a treasure hunt is a great way of doing it. And we can do them for quite small groups as well, so you don't need a great big group. And something we always recommend, and we'll come on and talk about a little bit more, is to get out onto the river, because Oxford looks, but again, like Windsor and like Henley, Oxford looks very different from the river. And there are some beautiful routes that that we can take your clients on. And maybe if they've done a walking tour or a treasure hunt and they want to sit back late afternoon, early evening with a glass of something bubbly and just take in the view and listen to the stories, it's a rather fabulous way to end the day in Oxford. Now, as I said, we are rather well connected, so we can offer some rather lovely tours of the colleges. Some of the art collections in some of the colleges are quite extraordinary, and they're tucked away and not necessarily publicly available, but we can include them in the tours. There's obviously the incredible Bodleian Library, and there is, and the name escapes me at the moment, Lisa might well be able to remind me, the biggest bookshop in the whole world is in Oxford. There's something like 3 miles or 30 miles of bookshelves or something like that. So if you've got anybody vaguely interested in literature, then it's certainly the place to go. And I can see something coming up in the chat, so she might have answered the question. Thank you, Blackwells. There we go. Much appreciated, Lisa. Thank you. I knew you'd know that. So lots of opportunities to go exploring books. Now, the other wonder of Oxford that we always really recommend is a glorious tour of the botanical gardens. Unlike many of these types of gardens, the gardens are located very, very close to central Oxford, so they don't have to travel too far. And it's an absolute treasure trove of plants and plant life and flora and fauna and all that sort of thing. So, and again, our expert guides will really bring it alive. And something that certainly quite a few visitors were enjoying last year was the link between a fabulous tour of the botanical gardens and then a visit to the it's called Toad, the traditional distillery, Oxford Artisan Distillery. And they obviously use a lot of the botanicals in the production of their drinks and so on. So it's a lovely, lovely link. And then obviously it's rude not to sample a few of the wares while they're there as well. So it's a nice contrast, and again something to add on to the tour. So when they get onto the river, again, there are a whole number of different ways of doing this. For those who are feeling a little bit more energetic and wanting to enjoy a bit of the action, going punting is as traditional as it gets. I think every film that's ever been made, every TV program that's ever been made, probably most famously Brideshead Revisited, you see people lounging with a glass of something as one of their friends is punting them down the river. If they aren't feeling quite so energetic, the wonderful thing is there are some chauffeured punts, so they don't have to put in the work. They can enjoy the views and sit back and take it all in. The same with the river cruises, and as with Henley and Windsor and so on, the opportunity to have a fabulous lunch or afternoon tea or just a lovely chill bottle of bubbles at the end of the day, whatever they prefer. There are boats, some beautiful old river launches, again very traditional for that part of the Thames, and they can sit back and take in the view and hear the stories from the hugely knowledgeable skippers, which is lots of fun. And you may well have seen rather a lot of the beautiful scenery in Oxford with some of our wonderful TV programs and a few films that have been exported. Inspector Morse probably has to be the most famous. He's even got a bar named after him in the Randolph Hotel, and all of the scenes and so on of them driving around Oxford and the surrounding area is fabulous. And if you've got a real Morse fan, obviously we can get the car as well, so they can be chauffeured around the area and imagine that they're joining Morse and his sidekick Lewis, who then went on for a series of his own, exploring the streets of Oxford. Harry Potter is quite interesting. There are some genuine places where filming was done as the students were going through the cloisters and the great staircase and so on. But the Great Hall, the makers of the film had to recreate the Great Hall because it wasn't big enough for what they needed to portray in the film. So they basically replicated the whole thing, but a bigger version of somewhere else. But you can see the original, which is really rather special. And you may well be aware of Midsummer Murders, which is the most extraordinary series, actually. The makers will talk more about this when we do our TV and film themed tea and training session. But Midsummer Murders was when they originally created it, they decided that in addition to Inspector Barnaby and his sergeant, that the other main character of the series was going to be the English countryside. And it's filmed all around here. It's been filmed in Henley and Windsor, a lot in Oxford and the surrounding villages, which is quite funny to watch. They do come up with some rather gruesome ways of killing people, but it's also a bizarrely very gentle detective series if you haven't seen it. But all of the beautiful countryside is all around here, which is just lovely. It's just wonderful. Now there are some rather lovely places to stay in and around Oxford. Our absolute favourite in the centre of town is either the Old Bank or the Old Parsonage hotels. They've both got beautiful restaurants. The Old Bank has a rather incredible penthouse apartment known as the Room with the View, because it has a view to end all views. I mean, literally across the top of Oxford. It is quite extraordinary. So if you've got some clients who want to feel as though they're on top of the world and stay in the city, then I don't think you could do much better than that, really. And just a hop, skip and a jump, probably about a 15, 10 to 15 minute drive away is Le Manoir, which is Raymond Blanc's beautiful hotel. We were talking about that as the home of a rather fabulous restaurant. So if you've got clients who would prefer more of a sort of country-based setting, a hotel set in grounds with lovely things to do, afternoon teas and all that sort of thing, Le Manoir is just round the corner. And then you've got the absolute ultimate, as we talked about a couple of weeks ago. They could choose to stay in Blenheim Palace if they've got the budget and the inclination to do so. Then we can make that happen. And Blenheim is probably about 20 minutes or so from Oxford. So there are various different options. Malmaison has a rather unusual venue for a hotel because it's the former Oxford prison. But the accommodation is a lot more comfortable than I think the prisoners had it back in the day, you'll be pleased to hear. So here are some of the wonderful images that your clients will see. I think the buildings and so on are just magical. They're sort of like honey coloured stone, make it really beautiful. Botanical gardens and also Harcourt Arboretum, which isn't too far from the city. It's just beautiful throughout the seasons. And then there's the lovely opportunity to get out on the river and see it from there. Now, it is described as being in the heart of the Cotswolds, and it's very much the Cotswold colour and so on. But to me, it's sort of the border. It's the start of the Cotswolds once you come out of the Chilterns. So it's as I say, not far from London, about an hour and a half or so. Obviously, a whole lot quicker if they jump in a helicopter. But it's fabulously central to go exploring. If they want to go down to the New Forest and Hampshire and so on, obviously it's right on the doorstep of all of the beautiful Cotswolds, and then they can just jump down to Bristol and Bath as well. So it's pretty good. It's a pretty good place to base your clients for 2 or 3 days. And Stratford, which we're going to talk about at the end of the week, is also about an hour or so away. So nice and central, which is just perfect. So There are lots of things that we can arrange for your clients. This is obviously a provisional itinerary, but you know, it's a maybe a lovely way to start the day is do a bit of punting, then a bit of a walking tour and or a treasure hunt. There are some lovely old traditional pubs in the heart of the city if they want a more sort of traditional style lunch. And then they can go exploring the colleges, and we can arrange for a lovely dinner in one of the colleges or a private dinner in the Bodleian. There are all sorts of lovely options for dinner. Oh, and preceded obviously by the rather lovely river cruise that they can enjoy. So whatever type of day your clients would like, we can incorporate it for them, and they'll have a wonderful time. And again, just to give you a sort of ballpark of what they can get and how much it will cost them, from a lovely tour, walking tour and river cruise and so on, through to the full Monty for the day. So it all varies depending on what your clients would like to do. So I hope that's helped and inspired you to include our stunning Oxford on one of the itineraries. So if I've missed anything or it's not clear, you'd like something else, please just fire away with any questions. Lisa, did I miss? Debbie, have I? Are you happy with the pricing guidelines that we share? That we shared as a guideline? Brilliant. Okay, jolly good. Wonderful. Lisa, have I missed? Oh, recommend Oxford for the day. Absolutely, because they your clients can do a lovely a sort of country route to get there or back, and it is only about an hour and a half away, but it that does mean 3 hours in the car if they do it there and back, but it's perfectly doable, and they could stop for a lovely dinner or something like that on the way home. Could you do a combination of Oxford and Cambridge? I'd really recommend not doing Oxford and Cambridge in a day. I think both of them probably deserve a day in their own right. And Cambridge is a cross country right over in the east of England, and would be, golly, probably a couple of hours drive from Oxford at least, I would say. So probably not. In terms of combining with Oxford, Windsor is probably about half an hour away. And they could, I mean, one of the best days really is maybe in the morning do Oxford and then go to Blenheim Palace, because it's just about 15 minutes away. And equally head up to go through the Cotswolds and either stay somewhere like Broadway, Chipping Campden, or Burford, one of those beautiful places, or go as far up to Stratford-upon-Avon, something like that. So we try, and you can do Oxford and a number of places in a day, but to really experience it and get to know it, I think it deserves at least half a day, and then jump up to Blenheim, and then you could they could pop back to London. So I hope that sort of helps. Okay, Lisa, is there anything that you would add about just things in the colleges and so on that we've done?
Sure. So I think a lot of visitors that come to Oxford, we find think that the university is one site or one building. If you're not already aware, that's not the case. It's a number of different colleges and sites and things like that. So on all of the walking tours, we can of course get them into some colleges, depending on what they like. If they've got families, then we can take them into the colleges where Harry Potter, for example, was filmed, or the Golden Compass, or anything like that. But some of the chapels in the colleges are absolutely beautiful. We can arrange for them to go and listen to Evensong in some of the colleges. So Wadham do a really nice one, which is sort of a 5 o'clock choir performance from the choristers at that college. Also, as an extra special treat, we can organise private dinners in the colleges as well. So we had a group come over from Kuwait last winter, and they wanted a private dinner. So I've got quite a few contacts at Balliol College, which is one of the biggest colleges. So they were able to go and have a private tour of the college with a student. So actually have a student's perspective of life as an Oxford student and life in the city and at the college. And then they had a bit of a tour of the old common room, and then a private dinner served for them. And it was all sort of catered for them. They were obviously from Kuwait, so they wanted a halal meal, so we can be super flexible with things like that. And also the Sheldonian Theatre, which is one of the oldest buildings in Oxford, you can also have a private dinner as well. So we can do some really special experiences for your clients, depending on the reason for their visit and on what they'd like to achieve. But a visit to some of the colleges is definitely a must. I wouldn't recommend all of them. It would take probably longer than a day. But that's just a bit of an overview as to what we can incorporate into the day, depending on what your clients are interested in or what they'd like to see.
Absolutely. And Brian, do you mean the camera obscura at the History of Science, the museum, Science Museum? Is that? Sorry, I'm going to have to admit here and put my glasses on. Yes. Now we have arranged this. Lisa, can you remind me?
If you mean the Radcliffe camera, that is specifically usually for students. It is a sort of a library area. It's the circular building that's sort of quite famous in Oxford. There's lots of nice places around Radcliffe Square. So there's a nice sort of coffee shop and restaurant as well there. So we can get access to that. Again, it is very specific. And they're quite tight on their restraints there, but so we just need to know as much notice as possible. But yes, we can certainly make that happen.
Absolutely. Great. Is there anything else that we can answer? Okay. Right, I think it looks like we've answered the question. So again, thank you so much for joining us. On Wednesday, we are going to be talking all things equestrian, horse riding and polo and all sorts of, and even having a dressage lesson with a member of our Olympic team, if you've got somebody who's interested. So there are lots of wonderful options from Windsor Great Park, going hunting and getting out into the beautiful children's countryside. So we will be sharing all of the lovely options, and carriage riding as well. So I'll be sharing all of the lovely options with you on Wednesday. We'll be sending obviously all of this through. Please do give us a shout if you've got any other questions, and we will look forward to seeing you on Wednesday. Thanks so much. Bye.